Hello friends, in the series of learning computer organization and design, today we will discuss about input-output interrupt under the topic of basic computer organization. So this is the entire agenda. We have already discussed the topics till memory reference instructions. These all topics are already been covered. You can refer to the previous recorded videos in order to learn these all topics. For your information, I will also provide you in the description of this entire video also the links related to these individual topics that we have already covered so far. So today, our basic agenda is about understanding the input, output and interrupt. So let's start understanding it in more detail. Now, before referring to the input-output interrupt facility, first thing is that, like in the previous recorded session, we were discussing about the memory reference instructions. So I felt that it is the necessary that we should know about the other two types of instructions also, which are existing within the basic computer. So right now, again, I would say by basic computer, I simply meant by the configuration of 4096x16, right? So 16 is determining the size of my instruction. So usually it comes like this: 0 to 11 bits will determine some sort of bit, the binary bits, right? 12, 13 and 14 are going to represent the opcode bits. And 15th bit is there, which is going to determine the mode of the instruction. So this also we called as the address bits, the 0 to 11 number of bits. Now my point here is that if the size of instruction is of 16 bits, then we have described that there are three types of the instructions that we can actually get from or within this basic computer: memory reference, then second is this register reference, which we are going to discuss right now, okay? And the third one is there, which is input-output reference. We will discuss in the next slide. So this topic is already covered in brief in the previous recorded session. So today we are going to focus on what are the instructions which come under the category of register reference. So for your simplification, here it has been described that this D7 register will be 1. So D7, we know that these are nothing but the opcode bits, right? So these 12, 13 and 14 bits would be equals to 111, and the value of mode bit should be 0. And these bits, which are describing from B0 so on up to B11, will actually help me in determining that and which particular kind of register reference operation I need to apply. For an example, this entire thing will remain same. That is why it has been written like this. So this I am again saying it is representing the 7th decoder output, right? This is the value I. So I is actually been complemented here because the value we are taking here is 0. So that is why it has been written like this. And this T3 clock pulse is simply specifying me that the execution of this entire register reference instruction will start at the arrival of the T3 clock pulse. And before it, we know about the instruction cycle as well, right? So in case of instruction cycle, we are having a fetch phase, we are having a decode phase, we are having a read phase, and then there comes the last phase, is the execute phase. So execution will start at the T3 instruction. So what we are doing is we are just referring this entire thing as small r. Reason being, because it will remain same throughout the register reference instructions. Now what kind of instructions can be called as the register reference? These 11 bits means there are 11 kind of operations available for the resistors, for referring to the resistor. The operations could be like this: if the B0 value is 1 and rest all values up to 11 are 0, this kind of activity or this kind of operation or the format of the instruction will simply say S is the start stop flip flop. So it will simply activate the flip-flop. Flip-flop is nothing but a part of resistor or storage element, right? So again, we are considering it under the category of the these resistors only or the storage element only. Similarly, if the B1 bit is 1 and rest all are 000, then it will be depicting that I need to clear the value of this overflow buffer, E buffer, right? And also then if E is equals to 0, if there is nothing, you could say that nothing is present in the carry bit or in the overflow buffer, then I simply have to increment the value of the program count. Similarly, when any of the individual bit among this B0 to B11 is becoming 1, it is signifying any sort of operation we need to perform on the resistors. So for your clarification, let me again aware you that you need not to cram these instructions. There is no need of that. Just for your understanding, it has been provided that these all are the operations that we need to perform over the resistors under the resistor reference instructions. Similarly, if we proceed ahead, then there comes the input-output instructions. So again, if I go through the same instruction format, which is consisting of 0 to 11 bits, then 12, 13, and 14 bits, which we are considering as the opcode bits, and the 15th, which is the mode bit, then here, input-output instructions, basically we are using them for transferring the information to and from the accumulator resistor. Because if you remember, in case of input-output instructions, when I was describing you the basics of the basic computer organization, there I told you that certain instructions will only refer to the input and output devices, right? Means they are purely dependent upon the input hardware as well as the output peripherals available. So these instructions will basically be depending upon these input and output units only. So normally, why we are using them? Some sort of data will be present in this processor resistor, which we called as the accumulator resistor. So we need to transfer the data to this particular and from this particular accumulator. We will use them. Then its second use is for input-output instructions is for checking the flag bits. I will explain you about the flag bits also. Flag bits are basically for determining the one bit kind of, one bit is been dedicated within the flip flop for telling me the status of any of the particular component. Like we are usually talk about E, overflow buffer, right? So E is having a one bit. We can signify that E is a flag. If this flag bit is active, it means some value, some carry values stored here. If this flag bit is inactive, I can say that, okay, there is no carry value stored here. So flag bits are something like that. Then there comes the another thing which we called as controlling the interrupt facility. So interrupt is important to understand here. We will also describe thoroughly now because this topic is actually about input, output and interrupt. So interrupt is something like whenever your system is seeking the, you could say that the presence of some another kind of external entity. Like for an example, if I say if I am working here on this particular machine and I will attach the external USB, a pen drive you could say. So what will happen? That pen drive will actually be an interrupt for your machine. It has interrupted the normal functionality of your machine. So such kind of facilities, we usually call them as the interrupt facilities. So how to determine that any particular instruction is falling under the category of input-output instructions? For them also, as I have described here, the value of D7 bit means these opcode bits will be equals to 1, and even this mode bit I will also be equals to 1, and the execution phase will start at the T3 clock. So this is the entire procedure, right? So how to determine that any particular instruction is falling under the category of input-output instructions? So here are the bits which we are signifying. So first 6 bits, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, 8, 9, 10, and 11. So these are totally 11 number of bits. So these first 5 bits will remain 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Reason being, we are only talking about the basic computer configuration, so we are having lesser number of operations available in context of input-output instructions. So that's why it is saying that the B6 value, if it is equals to 1 and rest all are equals to 0, then it simply determines me that I need to enable is off, interrupt enable is off, means interrupt enable is not activated. Interrupt has not arrived yet into the hardware equipment. If the next value B7 is equals to 1 and rest all are 00000, then it will determine that now interrupt is enabled. Similarly, as I said, in the input-output instructions, we will deal with the flag bits. So skip on the flag, input flag, output flag, some output character I need to take from the accumulator, some input character I need to take into the accumulator. So these all, you could say that overall would be the kind of input-output instructions that we need to perform. So their RTL notation is also defined here in brief. So let's understand about the input-output interrupt kind of mechanism in more detail. So this is the scenario that I have taken. So in this scenario, what I have done is, I have taken an input device, okay? It could be any input device. For this particular case, I have taken a keyboard. And I want some output from any of the output terminal or the output device, right? So for my category or for my case, it is the printer. So what happens in between? So here is a keyboard input device. Some input would be entered, like I will press any keystroke. That keystroke is been taken into this transmitter interface, because we know that there could be n number of input devices attached here, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, any kind of like mouse is there, and any other kind of input device can be there. All the input devices work upon their own mechanism of operation, right? Like keyboard basically works on stroking. I need to press, give some pressure on the keystroke. That pressure will yield a phonemic code. That code is to be taken into this transmitter interface, and only then it will be converted into the machine language code. So that pointer will be there. So that transmitter will ultimately now be able to actually code this particular, you could say that the alphanumeric character into the binary digit. Okay. So that binary code will now be taken by this INPR. So INPR is nothing but the input resistor, and OUTR is nothing but the output resistor. We have already learned about these. These resistors are the resistors of the basic computer, and we know that their size is always 8 bits 8 bits. So these two resistors are there. There is a accumulator being attached. So these FGI and FGO, these are nothing but the flag bits. Okay, these flag bits will help me in deciding whether the input resistor will take the input or not. Okay, similarly, whether the output resistor is ready to take on the output value or to work on the output value or not, it will be decided by this FGO, flag output, output flag. Then after the output has been converted, now it will be taken by the serial communication interface. That is nothing but the receiver interface. Now that binary or the machine code is to be transferred into the output device language also. So then only the information will be processed into the printer, and this is how the entire communication will take place. So in between, these are the simple lines we have marked, and these are the, you could say that the double lines being marked. It says that the parallel communication path, data is parallelly going into this accumulator, and from the accumulator parallelly it is going to the output resistor. But here the data will come in a serial order, means one keystroke entered, second keystroke entered, third, fourth, and so on and so forth. First of all, the first will be processed, then the second keystroke will be processed, third, fourth, and so on and so forth. Like this. Similarly, the output will be generated. First output, second output, third, fourth, and so on and so forth. So for this entire interrupt kind of mechanism to work, okay, so what I need is, I need an IEN kind of you could say that the interrupt enable kind of a bit or a flag. If this interrupt enable is active, only then this entire procedure will take place. Otherwise, this will not happen. So let's understand now how the flag bits are here to help me in performing this entire execution. First thing is, whenever you will enter the very first keystroke that will go into this receiver interface. Now, this flag input, by default, it will be zero. It means that it is available to take the data into the input resistor. So as soon as the status will be checked by the machine that if FGI value is equals to zero, this character is now being decoded and into the machine code, and now it will be placed here. Now, as soon as the input resistor will receive the data, the status of this flag bit will become equals to one. Now it means that no any other data could be taken into this input resistor now. As soon as the value is equals to one, it means this input resistor is already working on some data. It is already accommodating some data. It is not ready to receive the another data. So this FGI status will keep on letting the system know that input resistor is now busy. Once the input resistor has processed the input, it will send that input in a parallel way, the entire input into this accumulator. And then now from this accumulator, the input is actually to be taken into the output resistor. Now how this will happen? By default, this FGO value, the output flag bit, initially you could say, it will be equals to one. Like initially the FGI value was equals to zero. It means that your input resistor is ready to receive the data. Okay, here this FGO active means that this output resistor is ready to receive the data. So this is something which you need to understand. So once this accumulator has taken its data into the output resistor, now its status will be changed to zero. It means no more further input can be taken. It is already processing with some sort of the output data. Then, as soon as the output is processed and is being transferred to this receiver interface, this status will ultimately again change to one. And once the input resistor has also transferred the data to the accumulator, this flag input will again change its state to the zero. So this is how the entire communication will take place, okay, throughout this input-output configuration or input-output interrupt between the keyboard as well as the printer. So for happening this all this thing to happen, first of all, I need to check whether this interrupt enable is active or not. If it is one, only then this entire procedure will take place. Otherwise, if IEN value is equals to zero, this entire circuitry will not happen. So the exact process is again explained here. I will just skim it for a while. Like initially the FGI is clear to zero, 8-bit character will be taken, right? I think you can, I have already explained you this thing very well. I am directly proceeding to the very last topic, which is the flow chart of the interrupt cycle. So this is again an important thing, or the last topic you could say that, totally relevant to what we have already discussed. So if you remember, we have discussed two types of the cycles. One type is the instruction cycle, and second is this which we are going to learn, if some interrupt will happen. So how this entire procedure will start? It will start from this R flip-flop. If it is active, means some interrupt has been there, then it will directly refer me to the interrupt cycle. Okay, so how the interrupt cycle works? It will work the similar way as I have already explained you the entire scenario in the previous slide. Otherwise, interrupt cycle also works like a branch BSA kind of instruction. Okay, means it will start processing with the interrupt, the subroutine you could say that, but it will also define that the return address after processing the subroutine would be zero. Means the execution, if halted in between, if the subroutine starts in between, then where it should return, it should always be returned at the location number 0. And after this, what will happen? As at the location number 0, nothing will be present. So we need to increment the value of the program counter to 1. And then I will say the interrupt enable is not active. Even the R flip-flop, interrupt flip-flop is not active after processing the interrupt. This value will happen, and again, it will lead me to understand the R value. If the value of R is equals to 0, then what will happen? That it will simply process with the instruction cycle. We know how the instruction cycle work. It will work with the fetching and the decoding of the instructions. Then after decoding, the instruction read will start, okay? And after recording, if my system have analyzed that there is some interrupt enable been there, again, it might be the case after decoding some another interrupt arrives. If this interrupt enable is active, then it will check the input flag, the value of input flag, right? Like we have already described in case of the previous input-output interrupt cycle, right? So if the flag input is active, it will simply again set, now there is a subroutine bin there, interrupt bin there, set the value of R equals to 1, and then again start processing the subroutine. If the flag input is not active, it means output flag would not be active, right? So the process will again start execution from the normal zone also. Again, it will refer whether the R is equals to 0 or 1. But if the value of FGO is equals to 1, again, it means that some output has been demanded. Output resistor is having some value been there, or it is looking for some value, right? So it means that the interrupt is again activated. So this entire process will take on like this. Otherwise, if no interrupt has been there, then the normal execution operation of the instruction will be processed, like we have already studied in case of the resistor reference, input output reference, and memory reference instructions. So this is how the entire interrupt cycle will work. I hope that you have understood today's lecture. Thank you so much for joining the session.